with me on Skype this afternoon. I've got Malcolm Graham Wood. Malcolm, good afternoon. Good to have you with us.
Yeah, nice to be back with you again, Andrew.
Bit of a knockback here for Echo Energy today, following the test result from their fourth and final well in their Argentina program. I mean, what's your take on some of the numbers and what we're hearing?
Yeah, it is a bit of a disappointment, but only a little bit, to be honest. I mean, they would have expected better, because when they drilled it, they found that they had what they call significant gas and hydrocarbons through the drilling and the wireline logs. But what's happened is that it turns out that it's non or sub-commercial, because it's been depleted because of a well which was drilled not very far away and quite a long time ago. So it hasn't got anything much as I'd hoped. But ironically, you know, this is in the western side. The eastern side, which isn't very far away, is still flowing and will be economically viable without a doubt. Just looks like the old kitchen, or the hydrocarbon kitchen, has flowed, and it's flowing obviously into the other side. But so, you know, the share price not where it's at today. I mean, it was down short 20% when I last looked. Is overdoing it, because, you know, Echo have a number of multiple catalyst opportunities in this area, and this is just one of them.
Of course, this fourth well here, Malcolm, this was a last minute decision to switch. I mean, in hindsight, was it still the right decision to make?
Oh, no doubt. I mean, it showed from the original drilling that the possibilities were there. And of course, they've got other opportunities as well. And these are all in the Toby Fair or the similar areas. And I expect them to, I mean, they've got the rig on site for a while. So I'm expecting them to continue to do the pulling process or the workover as they expect. And that would give more opportunities to provide hydrocarbons in the short term. Then, of course, they're going with the same rig to do stimulation of the ELM 1004 well and the EMS 1001 well, which I think they've said will be moving later in the year. But ironically, these move quite quickly over in Argentina, and they've got a good operator with them. So I'm expecting, you know, what I would expect from Echo is a regular good news, or regular news. Some of it will be better than others. I'm expecting them to say that these pulling activities are underway pretty much already, and we expect good news from there. And of course, don't forget, they're still producing oil. So, you know, I think they'll announce before them in the next few days that they've produced and sold another load. And so, you know, this is from a standing start. You mustn't forget that they only moved into Argentina a few months ago.
Mm. And of course, we've got Tabiaki on the horizon. They're about to do some seismic there as well.
Yeah, I mean, this is the reason they did the modest placing a few months ago, because oilfield service companies are just starting to hike their prices, and so they got some prices for the autumn program of seismic, and they needed to press the button and take one of those prices straight away. So they raised a little money, but the good news was they brought in some institutions who are still happy. Tapiaiki is the real jewel in the crown here. I'm not expecting them to drill it until next year, but the seismic on this, and it's a huge amount of seismic, I would expect to get started, you know, in the not too distant future. And almost all the value that is in Echo in the CPR is in Tapiaiki. So you know, we've only scratched the surface of the potential value of this company in the last few months with these little wells here and there.
Malcolm, I want to have a couple of words here on SDX Energy. Interim results out today, of course. Net revenue's up 35%. Some really good numbers from them.
You know, this was a really solid set of numbers. And to be honest, quite often the historical numbers for these companies are less important than what's actually going on at the moment. But I think it's worth picking up that they produced revenue of $24 million. The netback number of 19 million was incredibly good, and that's due to increased pricing and increased volumes. They've got operational cash flow of $20 million, and they're still getting $3.5 million every month in this one. They're paying that. Their customers are paying down the receivables, which is good. They've got no debt. So in the various areas, in Egypt, for example, they've done extremely well because, in particular, in South Dusuk, they've found a lot of gas. South Dusuk will has got the capacity to do 60 million scuffs a day at the end of the year. Their guidance is still 50, but I think that that's just so that they can bring on the new facilities. But they've also got production, coming through and increasing in their other areas like Meseda and Northwest Gemsa. So I expect by the end of the year to see significant increase in production from Egypt. And in Morocco, don't forget they had that big successful well drilling campaign earlier in the year. And they've got a target there of 8 to 10 million scuffs a day. And they're already bringing on new clients. They've got three new clients they've announced in this set of figures, signing up the old clients. And the gas price is very strong in Morocco. And that's like, $10.50 to $12 now. And it's really high margin stuff, this, because I reckon they're pulling it out at less than a dollar. So very strong business. Very good numbers coming through. They're expecting to have the equivalent of about 8,000 barrels of oil equivalent a day at the end of the year, which would have doubled since the first half. And I'm expecting really good things. So they're in a very strong position. 20 out of 23 successful wells this year.
You can't grumble at that track record. Of course, Paul keeps talking about keeping a keen eye on opportunities to increase their asset base in North Africa. What are your expectations here?
Well, I think that they're always on the lookout for M&A opportunities, Andrew, and I think that that will continue to be the case. The difficulty is that in the last year or two, since the Egyptians, the economy's been doing significantly better and they've been paying their debts down, that all of a sudden there are other people. Every time they go to look at a potential deal, they find that there's private equity in the room with them and other companies. So they're in more competition, so prices are higher. But I'd be quite surprised if Paul and his team didn't do a deal at some stage in the next few months to add into this significant increase that they're doing in both countries. So they're doing very well.
Certainly. A quick word here, Malcolm, on FAR. Significant news from them today, gaining this ministerial approval for their farm out in Gambia.
Yeah, this is great news. I mean, they did this deal with Petronas some months ago, but it all depends on getting ministerial approval. But the Gambia is very exciting, and whether they drill at the end of this year or beginning next doesn't really matter. But for FAR, it'll be absolutely huge, which is why such a major company like Petronas is coming with them. They're paying 80% of the cost, and getting 40%. So it's actually a more than 2-for-1 deal, which is quite it's amazingly good in this day and age in the oil industry. So they've got back payments they've got a cash payment and a back payment. So as of today, FAR, I think it's about $17 million into the account, plus drilling, Petronas are drilling this huge Samo 1 well at the end of the year or next year. And of course, it's adjacent to Senegal and the discoveries that they've had with Cairn in Senegal. So, they were really smart when they suddenly realized that the Senegal field was of a world-class nature and B, might move further down south. They've just hoovered up the acreage in the Gambia, which is right next door. So, they're a smart company, FAR. They're sort of very high up on the bucket list this year so far. They're up by about 70% or so. But that's to 12 cents. The peak was only 13. I've got a valuation of in excess of 30 cents. So if you can trade on the ASX, this is one to have a look at.
And look, I've got to ask you this. What do you make of these developments here at Faroe Petroleum? Certainly interesting times and quite a potentially exciting story.
Well, I think this is going to be one of the big stories in the industry, probably towards the end of the year. I don't think. I mean, DNO first of all bought this stake from Delek, and then they added to it by doing a tender and so on. So they've got just over 28% of this company now. And recently they requisitioned an EGM in order to put two directors on the board. Now this is akin to inviting a fox into the chicken coop, because they're direct opposition, but they ain't nothing like as good as Faroe. And Faroe have worked with big shareholders in the past. They're not unaccustomed to that, but they are not going, then certainly not going to let the DNO have any, you know, any directors on the board. I mean, it would be ludicrous. And I think that DNO walked away from that particular one because Faroe have got their institutional holders on side, and DNO know that they would have lost that. But the wording from DNO in their announcement yesterday was pretty poor, pretty junior stuff, and saying that they were disappointed with Faroe's, you know, ability to do what might be called, you know, governance is pretty scandalous, because they've got all the number of necessary non-executive directors, and certainly a good deal more governance friendly than DNO, who the top two or three people at DNO run that show. But I think it's just that I think what happens is that DNO have bought their 28% pretty much on the cheap. If you bought less than a third of the company on the cheap, you can pay quite a lot more for the rest of the business and still come away with buying it too cheaply. So if I was Faroe, I would say that I would think it's almost certainly a bid coming. I don't think there's a bid high enough for Faroe that DNO would pay, because Faroe is, you know, really outstanding company. Over the years, it's had the best exploration success. Its strategy is, when it's had success, is to sell off a bit of it and keep a proportion which they can afford to pay for and put the money into more exploration. Their management is absolutely first rate. And, you know, I can see this turning into a right old bid battle. And let's just hope that the institutions and the retail don't sell it out on the cheap. I'm looking forward to this one.
I'm sure you are. It'll be interesting to see how it plays out. Malcolm, thanks for your time, as always.
My pleasure, as usual, Andrew.